Thank you, Benny. Wow. Thank you all, first of all, for being here early in the morning after a night last night. It's not easy. I appreciate everybody waking up and being present. It is an honor to be here this morning with all of you and to have the privilege to introduce our keynote speaker of the morning. Betty mentioned 1999 is my SSDP class year, and at the first SSDP conference, was then called the Student Leaders in Drug Policy and Justice Conference. One of the speakers was a father, the father of our next speaker, and he told a story about how his daughter was sentenced under the federal mandatory minimum sentences for 24 and a half years for a conspiracy charge that sent her to prison for the full time for the full weight of the cocaine that she had never actually touched herself. Having been a victim of an abusive relationship and not having any information to trade to the federal government, she was not able to plead that time sentence down. And in hearing the story in our first year as SSDP students, looking around the room, there were only five chapters, and I remember thinking to myself, we're gonna be hearing this story for the next 19 years. Every year, we're gonna get together. We're gonna hear from parents who look at their children locked up in prisons in America, and look at us as students and say, what are you gonna do to help us end this injustice, to right this wrong, to bring our children home? And I just remember thinking to myself, there's nothing we're gonna do to stop the federal mandatory minimum system with just five chapters and, you know, less than 50 students under this banner of Students for Sensible Drug Policy. That winter, the next year, the winter of 2000, President Bill Clinton commuted Kemba Smith's sentence, and we all celebrated. And a few years later, at the Drug Policy Alliance Conference in New Jersey in 2003, I had the great privilege of sitting on a panel next to our speaker, speaking about the importance of youth involvement in ending the war on drugs. To me, it was like sitting next to whatever the opposite of a ghost is, seeing somebody live in the flesh, that at the beginning of SSDP's journey, I thought we would reach our middle age before we ever got to meet this person that we cared about. And so it is my great honor, my great privilege to introduce to you today our next keynote speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a huge round of applause and all your SSDP love to Kemba Smith.
Good morning, Dan. Wow, you was trying to bring tears in my eyes for a second. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction, and I always give God honor for allowing me to continue to do what it is that I've been doing. And Dan, you're right, my dad is my hero, because even while I was in prison, most parents don't want to talk about having a child who's incarcerated, and all the dynamics that go along with my story. But my dad believed in telling any and everybody that he could, because he would say, you never knew who you would be sitting next to. And my parents are my heroes, because they stood by me when, you know, they made sacrifices in life to live a certain lifestyle, and I was their only daughter, only child, and they made the decision that they were gonna help me come home and get out of prison. And so, it's been important ever since December 2000. I've been out of federal prison for over 15 years now. And thank you. The moment I stepped out of prison and I got home, I would have these crying spells, because I knew that it should have been more of us that went home. I had a sense of like survivor's guilt, because I'm gonna try to kind of have some organization in speaking today without getting too emotional, but like Dan said, since my release, there have been other parents that have been vocal about their child being incarcerated under federal drug sentencing and mandatory minimum sentencing. And out of all the people that I know that receive commutations with a drug case, much less a crack cocaine case, I don't know anyone who just served 6.5 years in federal prison and had a president sign a document that was basically a get out of jail card. And so with that adage to much is given, much is required, because it wasn't something that just miraculously happened. There were several organizations, individual people, students who rallied behind the cause of freeing Kimba Smith. But it was more than just helping my parents get their only child home or feeling sorry for me. It was the fact that the fastest growing population within prison were Black women, and that I was a first-time nonviolent drug offender. And so people and organizations had thought that my case would set a precedent for other cases, but unfortunately, the only source of relief that I had after exhausting all of the remedies within the court system was executive clemency. So in coming out, I couldn't just move on with my life and forget about all of those people that deserved a second chance too. So ever since my release, I've been speaking out for those who are still in prison. And so I'm going to talk about some of my journey, but I do want to play a video because I think it's important for you all to see a visual, because Dan had the opportunity to hear my dad speak, but to actually see me in federal prison is another thing. And so I'm going to ask that a okay, sorry. There's no audio, so we're not going to be able to play the video. But basically, the video shows me being in prison in Danbury, Connecticut. Basically, initially when I went into the prison system, well, let me back up. Okay, so what led me down this path? I was a student at Hampton University. Basically, I was excited to be at a historically Black university because I grew up in predominantly white areas and going to school. And so I decided to go have this Black college experience. And I say this because I was excited. The first and only thing that was on my mind when I got to college, when I got on campus at Hampton University, was, oh my goodness, look at all these fine Black guys. Because I had never been around an environment where it was just so many fine guys. And so I had it in my mind, you know, this is for me. I didn't care what I was going to major in, what Hampton was good at. I just knew that's where I wanted to be. But understand, what happened to me at Hampton could have happened to me at Columbia University. My son is at Washington and Lee University, which I'll share with you about him. But they had a big drug bust on their campus about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. So I don't want you all to think that this is something that just happens on HBCU campuses. But basically, I saw this drug dealer who would come on campus. He would pick up upperclassmen girls, and I would just kind of wonder who this guy was, because he would come on campus in different cars, and when he would come around the student, at that time, that small little building was the student union and student grow where people hung out, but he would park his car in front of that area, and guys would come up to his car and talk to him, and I would see him, and I just wondered, you know, who is this guy? Why is he always on campus in different cars? And in my freshman year, my roommate at the time, she dated a drug dealer, and I remember her coming into the dorm room, new coach bag, new shoes, and I kind of wondered, you know, what that experience was like. But then when I went to a house party one night at my big brother's house, I told you I'm an only child, so he was a play big brother on campus. And so I met Peter. And one of the things that I dealt with starting out college was having low self-esteem and feeling as if I wasn't pretty enough, trying to fit in. I didn't, you know, seek out student organizations to kind of try to fit in. I just wanted to be a part of the cool kids on campus. But basically, when Peter noticed me and started talking to me, it gave me this warm, fuzzy feeling inside, like, oh my gosh, she's actually talking to me. And then eventually when I went back on campus, the girls came into my dorm room and they were just like, girl, what was he like? What were you all talking about? And for that moment, I felt like people were really paying attention to me. And so, had I loved me the way that I needed to, maybe it wouldn't have meant anything to me, but eventually Peter and I had these continued interactions, and eventually, I'm just sharing bits and pieces, he told me what it was that he did. I'm not one of those people that have been incarcerated to say, oh, I didn't do anything wrong, or I didn't know what he was doing, but basically, He told me what it was that he did and how he didn't like selling drugs and some of his ideas as far as moving into the business world. And so I know none of you young ladies or more mature ladies in the room have ever felt this way, but basically I thought to myself, well, maybe if I stayed with him, maybe I could help change him or influence him to live a legal lifestyle. Even though Gus and Odessa did not send me to Hampton University to convert some drug dealer thug into being a law-abiding citizen, somewhere along the way, I got that thing mixed up. But, you know, I share this aspect of my story mostly with young people to try to prevent them from making certain choices. But eventually, that relationship that I was in turned quickly into a violent, abusive relationship. And that's one of the things that was talked about in the video as well. And so the first time Peter put his hands on me, I actually thought he was going to kill me and thought that my parents were going to read about me in the Philadelphia Inquirer because we were out of town at the time. And so eventually, fast forwarding, he eventually killed his best friend because he thought his best friend was cooperating with authorities. At that particular time, I couldn't believe that I was actually with someone who had taken another person's life. And so it came a point in time where the federal government wanted him, and because I was his girlfriend at the time, they wanted me to give them him on a silver platter. And for me, I just basically went in and talked to the agents. I was very intimidated because it was about 8 federal agents in a room, and I went in the room and told them everything that Peter had instructed me to tell them. And so after that, Peter told me that he wanted me to meet him in Houston, Texas. And I met him in Houston, Texas. We went from Houston, Texas to San Diego, California, to Arizona, and then the last city was Seattle, Washington. And I don't want you all to think that I was this drug dealer's girlfriend. We were going from city to city, living the life of luxury. Basically, all the money had run out, and he was driving from city to city in a U-Haul truck and basically pawning odd items in that U-Haul truck in order to survive. And so when we lived in Houston, Texas, we were living in the Third Ward. Anybody familiar with the Third Ward in Houston? It's not a not-so-safe area. So there were bars on the windows, bars on the door, roaches crawling around an apartment. And then when we lived in Seattle, Washington, I remember where there were a couple of nights we didn't know where we were gonna get our next meal from. And we spent the night in a bus. We spent the night in the bus station. And so I realized in Seattle, Washington, that I was pregnant with my son. And I felt in my heart that I wanted to go back home because I wanted a normal lifestyle for my son. And I thank God for him moving Peter's heart to realize that he felt like he wasn't man enough to take care of me and that he needed to get me a train ticket back home. And so on this 3-day train ride back to Virginia, my biggest fear was my dad is going to kill me coming home pregnant. But when I got back to Virginia, I realized that my biggest problem was that I had been indicted by the federal government and my parents welcomed me home with open arms. And so I knew that I was supposed to turn myself in. My parents thought it was about who you knew, because at the time they had got me an attorney who was friends with the prosecutor, and the prosecutor said that if I turned myself in, he would give me a bond and give birth to my son. He reneged on that promise, so when I turned myself in, 7 months pregnant, I had to go back to county jail. And also too, he said that if I pled guilty that I would only receive 24 months in prison, and he reneged on that promise as well. And all of that is called prosecutorial misconduct. And so here I was, 23, pregnant, scared to death, and eventually I gave birth to my son, where 5 minutes after I gave birth to him, my leg had to be handcuffed and shackled to the bed. My parents were ordered that they had to leave the room. This was ordered by the U.S. Marshals because they came into my hospital room giving all these orders. And so I thank God for the woman who was head of the hospital at the time, because basically she came into the hospital and most people wouldn't speak up to the U.S. Marshals, But she came into my hospital room and she said, this is my hospital, I'm gonna run it the way that I want to, and she allowed my parents to stay in the room next door. Had that not happened, my son would have automatically gone into the social service system because there wouldn't have been anybody there to physically take custody of him. And so then after my 2-day stay of barely sleeping in the hospital because I wanted to make sure I spent as much time with him, I ended up going back to county jail. And for any of you all who have ever visited anyone in a county jail in the state of Virginia, there's no physical contact. So I wasn't able to hold, touch, smell, feel my son after I gave birth to him until later I was transferred into federal prison. And so eventually I gave birth to my son in December of 94, and then April of 95 is when I was sentenced. So I still hadn't been able to touch my son again. I was sentenced, it was a 2-day sentencing hearing, one of the scariest days of my life. The courtroom was full of people, supporters, hoping that I would be released. Several people wrote letters on my behalf. There was a Secret Serviceman that testified as far as my character, the ex-mayor of Richmond, Virginia, that testified as far as my character. There were two expert witnesses to talk about the domestic violence and abuse where my 86-year-old judge was sleeping during some of this testimony, and there were people in the courtroom that wrote letters as witnesses to the clerk of the court about seeing him sleeping and not paying attention. But eventually, my 86-year-old judge said that he heard everything, but basically he wanted to use me as a deterrent to others, and I was sentenced to 294 months as a first-time nonviolent drug offender. And so what was in my mind was just, this can't possibly happen to me, because I was only 23, and to be sentenced more than I had been actually living on this earth, I couldn't even process it. And so eventually I was transferred to federal prison, not only just a federal prison, but federal prison out in California, because since my sentence was over 15 years, I was automatically classified as a high security risk inmate. And so there were only two facilities where you could go if you were a high risk, which was California or Connecticut, and they said Connecticut was overcrowded. So I went out to California. Luckily, my parents were able to get enough money from family and friends, and they basically took a trip to California, and that's eventually when I was ultimately reunited with my son. But then later, I put in a hardship to be transferred to Connecticut when they had space, and I did go to Connecticut. But then there was a magazine called Emerge Magazine, and how many of you are interested in being journalists, writers? Great, I'm glad to see some of the hands. Please make sure you focus on doing some humanistic stories, because had it not been for the gift of the pen and this publisher making the dedication that they wanted to do a story like mine, it was a 21-page article where I was on the cover of the magazine in my high school graduation cap and gown, which I never in a million years would have thought that that picture would have been on a cover magazine, because I hated it. But the caption read, Kempis Nightmare, Federal Inmate 263-26370-083. I wish I could forget that number. I haven't seen it, I hardly ever see it, but I remember that number. But basically, had it not been for that article, I don't know, I would have originally been scheduled to be released in January of 2016 of this year. But I thank God again for that article, because basically it moved individuals, organizations. The NAACP Legal Defense Fund decided that they were going to take on my case pro bono. The NAACP back then, drug case,
no.
Drug dealer's girlfriend,
no.
They weren't taking on cases like that. And basically the woman who was director at the time, she was a native of Virginia, and she basically said she was going to do whatever she could do to help to bring her homegirl home, and she felt as what happened to me was unfair. And they filed petition after petition. Like I said, the attorney who was friends with the prosecutor was willing to testify to his ineffective assistance of counsel. The courts didn't want to hear it. And so my only source of relief was to receive executive clemency. And basically NAACP LDF Legal Defense Fund, they had a history with the White House and on the executive level Eric Holders, different people were involved in that, but there were also, again, some students from out of Dayton, Ohio that decided that they wanted to have a rally, raise enough money to come here to D.C. with their Free Kemba Smith t-shirts, their Free Kemba Smith picket signs, and they were on the cover of the Washington Post and the New York Times. And again, this wasn't just about freeing me. It was about changing public perception and changing the laws. And so again, once December 22nd, 2000 happened and those prison doors opened, and basically when I was, when I received this piece of paper from my unit manager while I was in Danbury, Connecticut, that stated that I had received executive clemency, but I looked down below and I saw this supervision for 5 years, and I was like, nobody said anything about me being on supervised release, but shoot, this was my get out of jail card, so I was gonna sign it. I didn't care what I had to do for 5 years. And so I was on, most people think executive clemency, you get a clean slate. No, I was still on supervised release for almost 5 years. I had a probation officer from hell. Basically, he scrutinized everything that I did. I had to record my speeches. I had to ask permission to travel outside of the state of Virginia. He would actually call me in his office and tell me what I should and shouldn't be saying in my speeches. But basically, I got through that. And it's been important for me to make sure I continue to advocate. And I thank God for Open Society Institute. I was eventually a Soros Fellow after I graduated my undergraduate degree in social work. I was able to be a Soros Justice Fellow, which, you know, organizations like this, organizations like Open Society, Drug Policy Alliance, all of those organizations helped empower me to be the advocate that I am today. Because just like anybody else coming out of prison, I was fortunate that there was an attorney who knew of my situation, who went to Hampton undergrad, and basically he offered me a job at his law firm. So I worked there for over 9 years as office manager and doing several things, but I filled out applications and didn't get a call. So it's very difficult for a person coming out, and it's still been difficult. You know, basically I'm fortunate where I have this platform to share this story and speak all across the country and internationally, and that's how I survived. It's not the most traditional way, and it was very welcoming to come into the room and hear another person standing telling their stories, because oftentimes we don't realize just how powerful our stories are. And so initially coming home, I focused on the part of my story of making poor choices through this journey. And basically, who wants to talk about how they screwed up? And then in this abusive relationship, and then you go to prison. That has taken its toll on me, but I've also healed from it and accepted it. But as I matured and transitioned, and I got married, and I have a daughter, my son, he's 21, I'll tell you about him, I promise, before I leave, but I have a daughter who just turned six on April the 7th. And when she turned five last year, it hit me. I was just like, oh my gosh, my daughter's five, and this is all I missed with bonding with my son and raising my son. And it actually made me a little angry at the fact of, when I really think about the total overall big picture, just, I know this is probably recorded, so I'm gonna be careful with my language, but forget my poor choices. Everybody makes poor choices at some point in their life. I don't care how good you are. But did those choices that I make warrant me receiving a 24 and a half year sentence? Hell no. And then outside of that, should I have even gone to prison in the first place?
No.
Shouldn't this country have an opportunity for people to seek redemption have second chances in life, because right now there's that scarlet letter that's going to follow me everywhere that I go because of those choices that I made in 1989. And here I am, this role model public figure. The governor of Virginia appointed me to this Virginia Criminal Sentencing Commission that I've been on for a year. I met President Obama a couple of weeks ago, him asking me about my journey. He took us, about eight of us, to Bus Boys and Poets in here to have lunch. It made me really realize how important my story is. But in going back to this, was I a threat to public safety? So I'm so grateful that years later, Dan, I know you talked about that you will be hearing the same story for years. And there are still my friends, Michelle West, Danielle Max, they've been in prison for over 24 years and have a life sentence. When they look at their piece of paper, they don't have a date. And they had never been in trouble before. What are we going to do in this country to stand up? And as students, I'm sorry to put a lot of the blunt on you, but we're the ones that start fires to make people realize that this shit is wrong. And there has to be something done about it. There should have been an opportunity for there to have been some probationary period for me to get my stuff together, be a mom, and be able to be out there to raise my son. And then after that probationary period, if I don't screw up, then there is no charge. But those things, this is how we need to start progressively thinking in our country, or we're just going to keep over-incarcerating people where there's over $35,000, $40,000 a year spent on people for no freaking reason. And so I'm going to continue. President Obama, I'm so grateful for him taking the time out for all of what he did. It just basically reignited a fire within me to keep doing what it is that I'm doing. And prior to the visit, yeah, I would say, well, what is President Obama doing? Like, he needs to do more in criminal justice. But after sitting and meeting with him and him taking the time to hear our individual stories, there's no other freaking president in the world who's ever done anything like that, ever shown any compassion. And so we have to continue to hold people accountable even after his presidency. Yes, the next president, he should go into a federal prison too. He should go into state prisons and know what some of these policies, how they're affecting people and their families. And are they effective? Are they sensible? No, they are not. So we need to start thinking differently as far as this war on drugs and sentencing and policy. And so I know I only have 5 minutes, but some of you all may, you know, be curious as far as legislation. There's a Sentencing Reform and Corrections Act of 2015 that's on the table, and people are trying to push it through the Senate. If you're interested in getting more information about that, feel free to go onto the Justice Roundtable's website. Also, too, there's an organization called Can Do Clemency. A friend of mine, Amy Pofall, she was incarcerated with me. She created this website and organizations. If you want to read other people's stories like mine who are still incarcerated to try to support them, you can go on there, candoclemency.org. Also, too, real quick, because I want to give you all time to ask questions. When I came home, do you think my butt could vote? No. There are several collateral consequences, especially in the state of Virginia, where I could not vote in 2008. Basically, you have this waiting period before you can even apply to get your rights restored. Eventually, in 2012, I did get my rights restored, but I had been working with the NAACP and was part of a delegation that went to Geneva, Switzerland twice to talk about voter suppression laws in the United States and the United Nations. And so I was very grateful. I mean, to be able to be in that position in the belly of the beast and to come out and be in some of these circles and let my voice have an impact has been very empowering for me. And so again, I just hope that you all will continue to push. And again, I was grateful to hear the story of the young man earlier, but if you all have your stories to tell, please make sure you're not embarrassed and you share those stories. And I'm going to close with this quote from James Farmer. And he said, anyone who said he wasn't afraid during the civil rights movement, was either a liar or without imagination. I was scared all the time. My hands didn't shake, but inside I was shaking. And for what it is that I do, when I think about this and the civil rights movement and I've heard various people speak, what I'm doing is nothing compared to what they did back in the civil rights movement era. We don't have that same amount of fear, but the only difference for me is because I've been in that situation, I know what a day is like, and I understand of how it rips up families. And so I don't care what kind of group I'm in, how professional they are, I'm gonna keep telling the story, and we're gonna make it the popular thing to talk about. Because we need to change people's ideas, even from our language. We need to stop saying ex-convict, ex-offender. Say formerly incarcerated, person who's incarcerated, because we are people first. And so if we want to change the mindset, the best thing is to make it a human issue where people see humans first instead of however they visualize a formerly incarcerated person. So thank you all so much.